from University Paris Sud, and he's going to talk on quotient stacks and italic variant cohomology algebras, Quillen's theory revisited.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I would like first to thank the organizers for this invitation. This is a great honor and pleasure for me to give a talk meeting on the occasion of the 70th birthday of Steven Kleiman and Aaron Timmis. Steve is one of my oldest and dearest friends. I've known him for over 45 years. As Ragni recalled, we first met in 66, 67 during Grothendieck seminar and SGA 6. And of course, I enjoyed Steve's talks very much. And as Ragni recalled, he certainly did and did very well what he had been assigned to do. And one thing you didn't mention is that he did even more, because he got an extra assignment about the same period, namely to write down notes on the standard conjectures that expose that Grothendieck had given. And the previous person who had been assigned to do that finally declined. And Steve, well, just bravely did that. And it's a beautiful contribution in this expose on on la cohomologie des schémas. And of course, we share many precious memories together, old ones, more recent ones. For example, Ragni mentioned Trieste, which was quite a nice conference. And Beverly at that time was there, which was very nice. And also more recently in Peresque, in honor of Grothendieck's 80th birthday. Thank you, and happy birthday, Steve. And now I will start my talk. It's joint work with my former student, Chung Weicher. It's a topic which stems from a question that Sarah, in the past few years, asked us about certain problems concerning finite group actions and traces in LID cohomology. And gradually, that led us to our study more general actions by algebraic groups and revisit a theory that had been developed by Quillen, actually, in the early 70s. So here's the plan of my talk. So I will start by recalling those first questions that we discussed about Serre's problems. And then we'd move to the main bulk of the talk concerning equivariant cohomology algebras for algebraic group actions on certain schemes, finite type of an algebraically closed field. So I will start with some simple things. So suppose you have an algebraically closed field K of characteristic P, and you have some, as people say sometimes, a variety, a K variety. So Grothendieck hated that word, because each time the author has to say what he means by that. While scheme, everybody knows. So here it means scheme separated in the finite type over K. And suppose the finite group G, a finite L group, where L is some prime number, which is different from the characteristic of K, acts on X. Then say observe that we have the nice congruence between the Euler Poincaré characteristic. Well, French people say Euler Poincaré characteristic. I think in America we say Euler characteristic of X and the fixed point set X to the G, namely the congruent mod L. So what is chi? Chi is the alternate sum of the dimensions of the cohomology groups, the etal cohomology groups with value in QL. Actually, here it's ordinary etal cohomology, but you could take cohomology with proper support and take the alternate sum, and you would get exactly the same number by result of Lomont, which was not known to Grothendieck, which was proven in I think 83. Actually, Grothendieck had proved that in fact other complex numbers, but the general case was due to Lomont. So the proof of this congruence is extremely simple. You first, by divisage on the group, you reduce the case where the group is cyclic of order L. And then outside the fixed point, the action is free. And so because L, so you get an étale cover of group Z mod L Z. And since L is prime to the characteristic, then you know by result of the link that the order Poincaré characteristic of X minus XG is L times the order characteristic of the quotient. And as chi C is additive, then the chi of X is the sum of chi of fixed point and chi of the open complement, and then you get your congruence. Of course, this is related to various other results by Delling-Lustig and other people. In fact, you can, instead of just looking at Euler Poincaré characteristics, you can look at traces. And traces are trace of G on of some element G in Z model Z. Then, in fact, for G outside of 1 is, in fact, on the fixed point, on the complement fixed point set is a regular representation. So then you get the Euler Poincaré of fixed point plus a multiple of a regular representation, which multiple is exactly the Euler Poincaré of the quotient. So this is a refinement of a previous formula. Actually, even in this formula, when one can ask whether the again, like in Lomont, you can exchange cohomology with no support with cohomology with proper support, and that's true also. That Weicher and I proved that. So, suppose L does not divide the order characteristic of X, then certainly, XG is non-empty. So you could take, for example, the affine plane, the affine space AN. Then its order point characteristic is 1. So then the chi of XG is 1 mod L. So certainly it's not empty. But you don't need such a formidable arsenal to prove that, as Serre observes in this case. Then you, by just a standard spreading out argument, you can reduce the closure of finite field, and then the action given on FQ. And then actually in this case, there is a fixed point defined over FQ, because you just count the orbits. So non-trivial orbits are, since it's Z mod L Z, so it's divisible by L. And so then, as the total number is the power of Q, then there must be a trivial orbit. There must be a fixed point. incidentally, say, ask whether if you work, let's say, on some field K, and you look, take the affine the affine space A n over K, and you have a finite L group G acting on it. So can you find a fixed point which is rational over the field? Actually, we have seen that for a finite field it's the case. And I know in Niquet's proved that for fields which are not so far from being a finite field, so actually Encelian DVRs, or being, let's say, algebraically closed, or fraction field of Encelian discrete variation ring, assuming some hypothesis that the residue field is either separately closed or finite and containing the Lth root of unity. So, but you see, as I said above, here, even for k equal to q and g plus or minus one group and n is 3, the answer seems to be unknown. for n smaller than 2, I think it's some papers, or the situation is described by some papers of Kraft. So now let's come back to K algebraically closed. So then we know that there are fixed points. But actually, it turns out that if the number of fixed points is finite, then on the affine space, it's only one point. This is rather strange. But it follows from a variant, algebraic variant of Smith's theory, which was devised by Serre and also independently by myself in 2008. So the result is simply that. Suppose G is again a finite L group, and suppose that X is modeled acyclic, which means that its cohomology is trivial in a higher degree. Cohomology with value in the finite field FL is trivial, and H0 is reduced to FL. So then the same is true for the fixed point set XG. So let me sketch the proof. So in fact, it's the results of Smith in topology go back to, those results go back to maybe the 30s, and they were revisited by Borel in the 50s, who saw that one can use some kind of equivariant cohomology to prove such results. Unfortunately, Borel's proof is rather lengthy and not so illuminating. Why? The situation is, in fact, quite simple. So what is it, this equivariant cohomology? So suppose in general you have some finite group G acting on some Y over K. Then the equivariant cohomology is defined in derived category sense by taking first the complex of cohomology with value in FL, which is a complex of the G modules, GFL modules, and you apply the R gamma G. So in particular, the cohomology of this complex, A star G, Y, is a graded algebra over A star G, which is the cohomology of just a spec K with the trivial action of G. So in fact, just the cohomology of G with value in FL. So for example, if you take for G the cyclic group, Z model Z, then its cohomology has been known for ages. You know that situation is different whether L is 2 or bigger than 2. So here is the result. So for L equal 2, you get just polynomial algebra on one generator in degree 1. And for L greater than 2, you get an exterior algebra on one generator in degree 1, actually just a dual number, if you like. Times the polynomial algebra on some generator in degree 2, which is defined, so this Y is defined as the Bochstein of X, or the Bochstein sequence given by Z model Z goes to Z model square Z goes to Z model Z, so H1 to H2. The key point is this. So you recall you have your X, which is the affine space, and you have the fixed point XG. So you look at the restriction map from cohomology of X to the cohomology of XG, but on the equivariant cohomology, so then the equivariant cohomology of the fixed point set, then it's just my Kunes, just tensor product of the cohomology of the XG and the cohomology of the group G. And the key point is that this map, when you invert this element beta x, this y, in H2G, in this algebra, then it becomes an isomorphism. So why is that? I sketch a proof here. It's because the defect between X and XG is concentrated in this equivariant cohomology group, which in fact is easily shown to be finite dimensional. So then maps coming from this finite dimensional thing to a polynomial algebra will be zero after you invert this beta x. So then you have an isomorphism after inverting beta x. So, but here you see h star g of x, so h star g of x star x, but h star x is just fl, so you get just fl here. And so then the right-hand side has to be fl also. So in fact, h star g, tensor h star xg, so h star x to the g has to be fl too. So it's a map between two free modules of rank one over this algebra H star G. So then this is the proof, this two-line proof. So then when you look at that, of course, it's similar to some localization formulas, which were proven, I think, first by Atiyah and Siegel and the K-theoretic context, and then Quillen, of course. Precisely in this context, and then for towards actions by Goreski, Kotwix, McPherson, and the formula I just mentioned that this map becomes an isomorphism after inverting this beta x can be generalized to other groups. So suppose instead of taking a cyclic group, you take a product of R copies of the cyclic group, so what you call the group of type LLL, or an elementary L group of order of rank L. So then the map becomes an isomorphism. The restriction map becomes an becomes an isomorphism after inverting a certain element, which is the product of the all classes in H1G minus zero of the Bochstein of that. So this is, but so this is again by dévissage on the group. But actually, it was reminiscent of Quillen's formula, exactly analogous to Quillen's formula for actions of the elementary abelian L group on the compact spaces. And in the case of Quillen, that result followed from a more refined structure theorem on such actions, a detection of these equivalent cohomology groups by elementary abelian ones. And so that led us to investigate the analogs in algebraic geometry. So now we can go to some more general situation. So again, we have, let's say, our field K algebraically closed. And again, X over K, which is separated from the finite type, and acted on not just by the finite group now, but by G, which is an algebraic group over K, a finite type. So far, I don't make any assumption. It can be an abelian variety. It can be an extension of a finite group and abelian variety. It can be several things, just a finite type. And I fix an L, which is prime to the characteristic of K. So now we have to define the, we can define the equivalent cohomology of X with respect to the action of G in the following way. So here we, so in topology we have the classifying space BG for any compact Lie group G. Here in algebraic geometry we still have the BG, which either classifying topos of Grothendieck or the classifying stack of G torsors, which is an algebraic stack, and we can take its cohomology. And again, we have our gamma x FL, which is complex of the BG, and we can take its global sections. And this is the definition of the equivalent cohomology. It generalizes the one I gave just a minute ago for G, a finite group. And equivalently, you could use the so-called quotient stack of Laumont and Moret-Bailly, so bracket X mod G, which plays the role of what we, in topology, is defined as this product, so BG, the PG, is universal. Suppose G is compactly grouped, then BG is the classifying space. Over it, you have a universal torsor. which is contractible, the total space contractible, and G acts on the boson PG and X, and you take the contracted product. So you divide the diagonal action. And then this bracket X mod G plays the role of this object. And in Quillen, you will find that equivalent cohomology is defined by exactly the cohomology of this contracted product. And here, in fact, the X mod G over S, so it is a stack, so it classifies what? So it the Cartesian diagram, where, so first of all, over this stack, you have a universal torsor, X over X mod G, so a natural projection, the G torsor. You can, if you like, you can take X, replace X by X cross PG somehow, since PG is contractible. So it's precisely this object here. And then just you look at the Cartesian square, so the torsor, there's some variable scheme S, G torsor, which are induced from this universal torsor. And in the case you take X to be spec K, then you just get BG, the G torsor. And so you have a map, a natural map from bracket X mod G to this BG, which is somehow a kind of a vibration of fiber X. And the Lorentz spectral sequence of this gives you the equivalence of the two definitions. So now the general thing. So this bracket X mod G in general is not a Dunning-Mumford stack. It's an Artin stack. If the inertia isn't ramified, then it's a Dunning-Mumford stack. And you could also, there's a theory which is which has to be taken with some grains of salt of the cohomology of those Artin stacks. There is a certain site, a smooth et al. Site, and then you can consider cohomology with value not just in FL but more general group sheaves F. Now, this functorial in the pair XG, this equivalent cohomology, and in particular, we have some nice so-called induction formula. So you can somehow you can enlarge your group G, so G acts on X. So enlarge it to a G prime. So G is contained in G prime. So G prime no longer acts on X, of course, but it will act on the contracted product X wedge. G, G prime. And if you take the quotient, there's a cancellation, you still get the bracket X mod G. So equivalent cohomology with respect to G of this X or with respect to G prime of this extended X wedge G, G prime are the same. Somehow, I come back to that. You see, what is interesting in that is that this equivalent cohomology, which was defined using X and G, in fact depends only on this quotient stack bracket X mod G, and not on the special representation. You can enlarge G and X, and then you still get the same cohomology. So main results are similar to Quillen's. There are finiteness results, gluing, or detection by elementary abelian L subgroups, and stratification of spectrum. So I will review these results. So finiteness. So G over K is an algebraic group scheme. So we have that BG, and you can look at this cohomology algebra, H star of BG with value in FL. So the first result, so it's star G here is the same as H star of BG with value in FL. So it is an FL algebra, graded algebra, intercommutative. And actually, this is an algebra of finite type. So exactly similar to the result of Quillen, that if you take BG for any compact Lie group, then the cohomology is a finite type. Second, So there is a nasty restrictive hypothesis here. If G is affine or connected, then E star G, which is a module of this cohomology ring, is in fact a finite module or finite algebra. So I should make a few comments about that. First of all, this is exactly an exact analog of the Quillen theorem for actions of compact Lie groups on the, let's say, compact spaces, also on some paracompact spaces with certain restrictions on the cohomological dimension. Now, for G affine, or G and abelian variety, so the first statement, that is this A here, sorry. So Wager and I, we proved it. It's not so difficult. In fact, we proved the B for G affine. But we were stuck for a general case. Actually, an arbitrary algebraic group has a dévissage. So you have the connected components. It's an extension finite group by the connected group. Assume it's smooth. And then you have the smooth group. So again, by Chevalet, you have an algebraically closed field here. By Chevalet, it's an extension of the abelian variety by an affine group. And the problem is to work out all these extensions. Well, okay, great. I have Hochschild serres, Lorentz spectral sequences, all that. But that leads you nowhere, actually. Especially the worst case, the extension of the finite group by an abelian variety. This is complicated. So I was stuck when, in fact, I asked the Ling about that, and he thought a little bit, and in one night he produced a proof, and a very clever proof, which in fact proved the A, but still not B with any assumptions. Idea of the Ling is to somehow as much as possible, replace the abelian variety by the L-divisible group, corresponding L-divisible group. And of course, there's an infinite process there. But if you take a P, then it, you get an affine group. So you have extensions, but eventually you reduce to the affine case. So, of course, we hope that the restrictions are in B are superfluous, but it's still work in progress. We cannot prove it so far. So in the case that G is affine, then the proof is quite simple. You use this induction formula. So G is affine, so you embed it in some GLN. So then you are reduced to GLN. So, but then the cohomology of the GLN, BGLN, was known. In fact, at the time of SGA6, there was also some seminar on crystalline cohomology. And I asked the Ling about, again, about the RAM cohomology or crystalline cohomology of BGLN. And of course, we would expect that it would be a polynomial algebra of the Chern classes C1 up to Cn. And I couldn't do it. And then he found a very nice approximation argument, which worked for the RAM, and which later I used in my note with Berthelot to define Chern classes in crystalline cohomology. But of course, the argument worked just as well in etal cohomology, and I think the proof was written up much later by Behrend. So in any case, we know it. And then, of course, you use the Lorentz spectral sequence here. Sorry. And then, of course, you get the finiteness over H star L, and a fortiori over H star G, because this is a module over H star L. Now, gluing, so this is the finiteness result. Now, how about the gluing? So I have to come back a little bit on to elementary abelian L groups. So let me recall the structure of its cohomology. I explained it for rank one, but in general, what do we have? So suppose A is isomorphic to a product of R copies of Z mod L. So H1A, well, it's just a morphism from A to FL, the dual, a check. And we have the Bochstein from H1A to H2A, which is injective. And the H star A, again, for L equal to 2, is a symmetric algebra over HH. And the exterior algebra over HH, tensor, a symmetric algebra of the beta HH for L greater than 2. Now, suppose now that G is an algebraic group acting, say on the right, on X over K. So we emitted a equivalence construction. We define a certain category, a GX, which is as follows. So the objects are pairs consisting of an elementary abelian L subgroup, A of G, or of G of K, if you prefer. And C is connected component of the set of fixed points by A. So the maps, well, you look at the maps from A to A prime. So homomorphism from A to A prime, so it's a finite set, which has the property that they are given by conjugation within the whole group G by some small g. So the U from A to A prime is conjugation on the right by G. And in such a way that this conjugation sends A into A prime. And of course, that the fixed point of that component of fixed point under A, translated by G, contains the component C prime. So in particular, this is a finite subset of a subset of the finite set of a homomorphism of A to A prime, so it's a finite set. Moreover, it turns out that the whole category itself is equivalent to a finite category. In fact, there are only finitely many classes of objects up to isomorphism because, in fact, there are only finitely many abelian L subgroups of G up to conjugation. So this seems to be somehow a known result, but we learned it from Serre. In fact, an orbit calculation shows that if you have any finite group H, whose order is prime to P, and you let it act on the homomorphism of the scheme of homomorphism from H into G, you let it act by conjugation, then the orbits are open. So then A is equivalent to finite category. So in for any object AC, so A elementary abelian L group, and C a component of the fixed point, you have restriction maps from equivalent cohomology of X, the cohomology of the fixed point, and you restrict also to A. So then you restrict to the component C, so it decomposes into a tensor product, the cohomology of C and cohomology, so which is a finite dimensional thing, and the cohomology of A, which I explained a minute ago. And then you even restrict to H0 of C, which is just FL. And so you get a map from the algebras from H star G of X to H star A. Now, if you look at a map from a pair AC to a pair A prime C prime, so the maps are given by conjugation by some element G in G. Actually, on the whole cohomology A star G of X, that conjugation acts as the identity. So then, you get here, you would have an identity, H star G of X, and the restriction map. So then you get a commutative diagram for restriction maps to A and to A prime. So you get a map to the projective limit. And the result, like in Quillen, is that for G, now again, I have to make some assumptions, which I hope, we hope are superfluous, that G is either affine or an abelian variety. And in this case, this map is an Quillen terminology, is an F isomorphism, which in fact simply means that kernel and co-kernel of this map are nilpotent. So in fact, they're killed by some power of Frobenius, but it turns out it boils down to just being nilpotent. So that's what I said. That's exactly analog Quillen theorem, and we hope that the hypothesis, the restrictive hypothesis, are superfluous. And as in Quillen, we deduce a result on the dimension of the spectrum of A star G of X. Of course, you have to be careful because it's a non-commutative algebra. So what is the spectrum? Then you divide by the two-sided ideal of nilpotent elements, so you get the perfectly honest algebraic, the perfectly honest commutative algebra, and you take its spectrum, so it has a dimension. That dimension, by the way, is the order of the pole at t equal to 1, the Poincaré series of A star G, which I recall here. And in fact, this description as the projective limit, with a finite category, essentially, of this A star A, then you get that you just get the maximal rank of an abelian L subgroup for which there is a component which is non-empty, that is the maximal rank of an abelian elementary subgroup of G fixing some point in X. So just to make you believe that this is okay, just you take the simplest case, take G equal to GLN, then we have seen that H star G is, in fact, this polynomial algebra, so it's the dimension n. And on the elementary abelian L group side, then any elementary abelian L group is conjugate to a subgroup of the standard torus in GLN. And of course, the maximum rank is precisely n. Of course, from this amalgamation theorem, you can prove the localization, of at least some part of the localization formula I explained before. Namely, when the fixed point set XG is empty. So because, in fact, fixed point set empty means that at each point, the stabilizer is smaller than G. So then you can, if you have some smaller group A than G, then you can find, so it's some hyperplane which contains it, and then you find some class in H1 which dies in H star A. So you have a class which dies in H star A for all these groups. So then you take the product is a finite product, so it dies in the projective limit, and by Quillen, by the analog of Quillen, then it some power of it has to be important, and then it has to kill this A star G of X. But in the general case, Quillen used some tubular neighborhood argument, which unfortunately we are not able to make work in this context, and we had to resort to a different proof. Now, geometric interpretation. So first of all, for an elementary A, so we have the symmetric algebra of the dual, so the AHH is FL to the R. So it's the spectrum is just the affine space of rank R over FL. And the spectrum of H star A reduced, where I divide by the nilpotent element, is just this A underline. So an affine space of rank R over FL. Now, Of course, you can now look at the restriction map, which are restrictions of homomorphism of graded algebra. So it gives you Mach backwards on the spectra. So the, this A underline goes into the spectrum of the reduced cohomology ring, A star G of X. So then you get backwards the map from the inductive limit of this A into the spectrum, and you can somehow reinterpret the previous result by saying that this spectrum of the equivalent cohomology ring reduced is homeomorphic to this amalgamation, this inductive limit of this affine space as A. So it's a universal homeomorphism. So it, finite radiation interjective in the technical terms. So it, this theorem is really a gluing theorem, this theorem 3.2. So you take the simplest example, you take a projective line, and you take a G equal to GM. So what are the fixed points and the elementary things? So then you have the elementary, you have just mu L, and you have fixed points 0 and infinity. So you have the pairs mu L 0. You have the pair mu L infinity, and of course you can take the trivial group 1 and the component x. And so you have three objects, and so you have for the mu L 0 and mu L infinity correspond to two lines, and they have to be amalgamated along this one x. So you get a cone over 2 points. Of course, you can go a little further and analyze the spectrum and as a, and give some stratification of it. So if you consider the map from A underline to X underline, which is the spectrum of this reduced cohomology ring, then this map actually is a finite map, and you can take this image of this affine space, so it's a closed subscheme of X. And then, in fact, it turns out that those closed subschemes corresponding to these elementary A's form a stratification of X in the sense that if you remove from this VAC the union of the VA prime C prime for a smaller A prime, so you get an open stratum. And similarly, you remove from A underline this affine space all the hyperplanes, something like in the Drinfeld construction. And then you get that actually, then the open stratum V plus AC is a quotient of the A plus by the automorphism group of AC, which is a finite group, so a Y group, if you like. And in fact, you have a stratification of the your space X as a disjoint sum of the Z plus AC parameterized by a set of representatives of the object AC. Moreover, if you look at this VAC, the closed thing, so just like in Quillen's result, these are just the integral closed subcones, the corresponding prime homogeneous prime ideals, which are stable under the Steenrod operations. So let me recall here the Steenrod operations. So there are Steenrod operations on this cohomology. For example, you can apply some formalism by Epstein because you have the cohomology of the site and value in FL. But you can define it maybe in a simpler and a more direct way. So the PI for L equal to 2 send H star to H star plus I. And here for L greater than 2 into this thing, plus 2 times L minus 1 I. And in such a way that if you take the P sub T, which goes from H star G of X to H star G of X bracket T, by the Cartan formula, it's a homomorphism of algebras. And if you take X of degree 1, then Pt is just x plus x to the lt. So it's all what you have to know about the signal operation. So the main point is result B, actually, is a result on the affine space itself. So the affine space itself, or FL, can be viewed as the spectrum of the cohomology ring of Z mod LZ to the R. And as such, it has a Stirner operation, and you can ask what are the integral subcones, which are closed integral subcones, which are stable under Stirner operation, and it was proven by Serre long ago that, in fact, those are just the subspaces, the linear subspaces. So here again, in the previous example, you have the stratification, of course, by the two lines and then the intersection of the two lines, which correspond to one x. In this case, the automorphism group of the component AC is just trivial. Now, I would like to, maybe 10 minutes, to say a few words about the proof and also the sort of generalizations and problems around this. So suppose G is affine. So the case of an abelian variety is treated separately, but in some similar manner. And so we want to show that this map from A star G of X into the projective limit of the A star A as kernel and co-kernel, which are important, and F as a morphism. So the strategy of the proof is equivalent with three steps. The first two steps are similar to what he did, but the last one, of course, requires new ideas. So the idea, again, is that you, since G is affine, you embed it into some GLN, and then you do this trick. You consider the standard maximal torus, T, in GLN, and in it, you look at the kernel of S power map, so the elementary abelian group of rank R, I call it S, and you look at the coset space L mod S, right coset, and you let G act diagonally on the product of X and this set of right coset L mod S. So of course, if you are interested in the stabilizers, and a stabilizer of the point here, of course, will be, because it's a coset L mod S, it will be a conjugate to a subgroup of T, so it will be some abelian elementary group. So it will conjugate to S, so it's an elementary abelian L subgroup of G. And of course, some extra conditions have to be satisfied because you have taken a product and the diagonal action. So in any case, the stabilizer for any z in this product is an elementary abelian L subgroup of G. And the closer analysis shows you that the map, this natural map, G cross Z to Z cross Z, which is given by GZ goes to ZZG, is a finite map. So the finite group point, in some sense. By some descent argument, like in Quillen, you can reduce to this case. So by first working with X cross F instead of X, and then working with X cross F cross F instead of X, and a little work. So you reduce to this case where the map, this standard map here from G cross S to X cross S is finite. And second, all stabilizers are elementary abelian L subgroups. Now, of course, you have an enormous algebraic group G acting on X, so it's hard to define a good quotient of X by G. But for the purpose of the proof, you can use the Kilmorich result. that in fact that that quotient stack bracket x mod g, it's a stack, but it is a coarse moduli space. So what is it? So because of this finiteness of x quad g to x cross x. So you have a map pi from this stack bracket x mod g to y. Y is some algebraic space, and the property is that this pi is an initial among maps to an algebraic space. And of course, it is a coarse moduli space, so it means that any time you take an algebraically closed field K, extension of K, then the set of isomorphism classes the object of bracket X mod G of K, that is those G torsors over spec K together with the map, equivalent map to X, goes isomorphically to the point of Y over K. And in fact, this map is proper, and in fact, it's a one-to-one. It's a universal homeomorphism. It's not an isomorphism, but it's a universal homeomorphism. So if you take inverse image of one of a point y in y, so you look at the fiber. So the fiber might be usually is not reduced, but if you take the reduced thing, then you get, of course, one class of isomorphism of objects. So you get, in fact, an orbit of x under g, where x is some point above y, modulo g. So you get this stack. So, but this stack, x g mod g, boils down to be the classifying stack for the stabilizer gx. So this map is a vibration, and each fiber is a bgx for a stabilizer gx. Now, the key lemma is, like in Quillen, you look at the at this Lorentz spectral sequence for this pi, and you have a homomorphism from H star G to H0 of Y with value in H star. So on the zeros vertical, on the vertical line. And in fact, using a multiplicative structure of the spectral sequence, you see that actually this is a uniform F isomorphism. So kernel and co-kernel are nilpotent. So now, then we are reduced to, we can forget about the equivalent cohomology ring we started with, and we concentrate on this global section of Y, this algebraic space with value in this this RQ pi star FL. And we have to compare this with the Quillen's limit. Now, here we have to use a little machinery on the cohomology of algebraic stacks. But in this case, it will prove it in a simpler way. But anyway, by Olsen, we know that those direct images, first of all, are constructible sheaves of FL. Constructible FL sheaves, each RQ. And also, because the map pi, this coarse moduli, map pi to the coarse moduli space is proper, then you have proper base change. In particular, if you look at the stalk of this direct image at some point y, so it's the cohomology of the fiber. Of course, the reduced element, your non-reduced thing, you can forget about it. It's ital cohomology. So you get the cohomology of BGX. So now you have a constructible sheaf on some space Y, and you know all the stokes, and you know also all the specialization maps. So it's a classical result, though. Unfortunately, I couldn't find any reference in SGA4. That you have a Noetherian scheme, a constructible FL sheaf. Then the global sections are just the limit of the stokes according to specialization maps. So it's, of course, it's an easy result, but still. So you use that. So what you find is that this H0 is a projective limit of this cohomology of BGX. BGX is the classifying space of an elementary abelian group. So the limit, the projective limit, being taken on the category of geometric points of Y. So it maps from, let's say, y to y prime is sending strict localization at y to strict localization at y prime. In particular, y is in the closure of y prime. But now comes the last step, which is more difficult. You have to compare this projective limit with that of Quillen. So here we need some new object, new technique. So when we deal with a scheme, then the category of geometric points is fine enough. But when you deal with some stack like bracket x mod g, so we need something which remembers the action of g. So we define this notion of L elementary point of bracket x mod g. So first of all, it's given, so it's a map from what I denoted by S mod A, bracket S mod A. S is strictly local scheme, 2x mod g, so it's on the map of stacks, which I want to be representable. And A is here, is some elementary abelian L group. And you assume that it acts trivially on the closed point of S. So actually, a map like that is determined just by an ordinary point of X, a geometric point, a map from S to X. And also an inclusion of A into the stabilizer of G at S. And the maps between such points are, of course, two commutative triangles like here. So from SA to S prime A, the two commutative. So the two commutative means that there is some two map here, which is given by some conjugation. A map from A to A prime, which is given by conjugation by some G here, which has to send A into A prime, and in such a way that the composition is from S to S prime to X is commutative, and A prime to G, the composition is the conjugation by G. So anyway, we can make a category out of that. We insert the map which are irrelevant, like the map which send S to S prime with send close point to close point and induce an isomorphism from A to A prime. In general, it's just injective. And the key compatibility is that you have some, first you start with your limit. So that was the H0 I was considering. Of RQ pi lower star, this limit along the geometric point of y. So then it can be reinterpreted as so each gx is some elementary abelian group A. So here you get a similar limit, but under this category of L elementary abelian point, which somehow takes into account the specialization maps, but together with the actions, the various actions of the stabilizers. And eventually, this goes into Quillen's limit, and all these maps are isomorphism. And we compose, we take the composition of that with the map from the cohomology, equivalent cohomology to this H0, and then you compose with this chain of isomorphism, then you just get Quillen's map. Yes? Pardon me?
Can you wrap up?
What?
Can you finish?
Yeah, am I over time? How much? I thought I started at 10, no? No?
It's 45 minutes.
No, I started at 10, no?
Yeah, you did, but it's 45 minutes to talk.
I'm sorry. 45 minutes? I'm so sorry. I completely forgot. Apologies. I'm very sorry. I thought it was 1 hour. Oh, yeah, I am very sorry. Using that, you finish. So I will skip the generalization. So thank you very much.